Good morning, everyone. It is Wednesday, November 24th, the day before Thanksgiving, and we are delighted to have you with us because we are going to continue along the lines of our music special and show you today how a hit record is made. Our field producer, Ed Deba, is going to actually visit a recording studio and visit a group by the name of Private Lives and show us how they have made a hit record. Join us. This morning, our field producer, Ed Deba, is joining us. He has done a special feature on how a hit record is recorded. We're going to find out a little bit about that. Good morning.
Good morning.
Nice to have you on the show for a change.
Thank you.
Gosh, nobody ever gets to see you. You're busy editing.
See the names on the credits.
That's about it, really. It's nice to have you on the show. And the first thing I'd like to find out, Ed, is why you were interested in doing a feature on how a hit record is recorded or made.
A couple of reasons. Austin's been a big music town for years.
Yeah.
And we all know that, but now with it becoming what they're calling Austin the Third Coast, not only for movies but for records, also a lot of people are recording here. Willie Nelson has a studio. There are a lot of recording studios that are putting out records, and since a lot of people never get to take a look at how those records that they listen to on the radio are made, we decided to go into the studio and take a look with a local group called Private Lives.
Very good. Now, is this song actually a hit that we will see them record?
Not yet, but it could be on its way.
All right, very good. Let's take a look at how a hit record is made, hopefully.
For many years, the majority of the records you bought at your favorite record store or listened to on the airwaves of your favorite radio station were recorded at studios in larger cities like New York, Los Angeles, Nashville, or even overseas in England. But with the emergence of Austin as the entertainment industry's so-called third coast, more and more records are being produced right here in smaller yet equally adequate facilities like the Ruff Cedar Recording Studio in South Austin. This is the control room of the Ruff Cedar Studio. This large audio mixer with all of its knobs, buttons, and levers that I'm sitting behind is the master control board used in every recording session. Now, what many people don't realize is the great amount of time spent here in recording a single 3 or 4 minute song. In many cases, it's not unusual to spend as many as 24 hours of actual studio time over a period of several weeks just to finish one song. Inside the studio on this day, an Austin group called Private Lives is preparing to record their first single. It's a song called When the World Comes Crashing Through, written by lead and rhythm guitarist Ron Rogers. This is the first of what will be many sessions here in the studio for the band over the next 10 days or so before the song is finally completed. Right now, though, before the tape recorder ever rolls to begin recording the song, the four members of the group are meeting in the studio with their British-born producer, Peter Butcher, to work out the final arrangement of the song. To do that, they'll play through each section of the song several times, and then through the entire song several more times. Along the way, they'll detail and refine every note to be played by each instrument, the drum patterns played by drummer Chuck Turk, the guitar chords played by Ron Rogers, the bass lines of bass guitarist Ronnie Johnson, and the vocal arrangement sung by lead singer Deborah Giles. Collectively, under Butcher's guidance, the group will arrange the song exactly as they want it recorded.
And we'll try it and see if it works. It may be too long. It depends on how long the fade's going to be. We like to have a reasonable idea of what we're going to do when we come in, but when you actually start to lay it down, or you hear it through earphones, it's the way that you think it's going to go, it doesn't actually turn out that way. All right, hold on. Let's go back to the top. Just take a few bars of the just the bass and the drums, and just hang out for a second. Let's see what we've got here. On the bridge, if you want to call it that, maybe we should have a little bit of, you know, power or something or other. All right, hold on. Can you do something about that bass line, Ronnie? Yeah, the da da da. Yeah, maybe just a simpler rundown, you know, I don't know, da-da-da-da-da-da, something like that. All right. Speed's right, I think, don't you, Chuck?
Yeah.
All right, try it again. Yeah, that's better.
I don't know that there are any hard and fast rules about producing. It's a personal thing. In my particular case, I like to be amongst the music itself, the arrangement, the key, the drum pattern, the bass line.
Right, now go into the bridge. No, just you give it two bars and then go into the bridge. Da, 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 da. Yeah.
What? Where?
I'll just watch me. I'll count you in. Same place again.
What's the word?
Some say the dreamers. Oh, yeah.
Was it the first of the song?
Oh, you were? All right then. Go again, Chuck. That's great. I think we need to do something at the beginning.
Yeah,
weren't
you thinking about doing some kind of vocals at the beginning of that?
Yeah, yeah. Maybe we can do some harmonies or something at the beginning. Instead of doing maybe what everybody else does, which is just, you know, straight in with music, maybe we can come in with some vocals in some way or another.
What kind of vocals are you talking about?
Oh, some harmonies
like
of some sort. Some
words?
No, maybe some oohs or some ahs or something like that. I'll tell you, before we go into this business of how we're going to do the beginning, let's start from the top as normal, and let's maybe pay some attention to what Ron's doing, because we kind of left him out, didn't we? Why don't you play a few bars of what you were doing there, just on your own, when you get in tune. That's better, isn't it? Run the chords up to the... Yeah. Those new strings don't like it much, do they? Pick it up where you would be at the beginning.
I can do that with the rhythm part.
Right, yeah. Nah, even if it were in tune, I still think we need to do that bit as an overdub.
Yeah, right.
Is everybody happy with the speed and the general feel and whatever? No one person does this. I mean, I guess somebody's got to get the credit, you know. Somebody's name gets put on the bottom of the record as the producer, which is very nice for the guy whose name it is, but it's not one person in this particular case. There are five or six of us involved. Everybody's got their input. You know, one man can't think of everything.
Once the music and vocal arrangements have been completed to everyone's liking, the long process of actually recording the song can begin.
You happy with it?
Yeah.
All right. Let's do it.
The song will be recorded. Ron Rogers, who is recording, gets the equipment ready. The initial recordings will be made on a 24-track reel-to-reel tape recorder using a tape 2 inches wide. The 24-track recorder electronically divides the 2-inch tape into 24 separate and smaller tracks of tape. That enables a different instrument or vocal to be recorded on each track. For instance, for the rhythm tracks, which will be laid down first, the bass guitar will be recorded on one track and the rhythm guitar on another track. Recording each instrument on a separate track allows any of those instruments to be played back alone or together with any or all of the others. That will provide greater versatility later when the song is mixed into its final form. Before the recording starts, though, Ron sets the levels or volumes on the audio mixer for each instrument. Everything being recorded first comes through this mixer and then is fed to the 24-track recorder. To make sure it's recorded properly, Ron must set the levels for each track.
How about your bass now? Play the riff you're going to be playing. Mainly what you're supposed to do is get the signals that the instruments are making and get it put on the tape correctly so it sounds good. Try to balance it out, which is, you know, a real important thing. Get everything balanced so you can, you know, hear each instrument clearly. For me, the actual recording of the music is the hardest part. The work comes, you know, the part that I think is the work is actually getting out there and sticking the mics up there and making the instrument sound good.
Since Ron will also be playing rhythm guitar on the initial rhythm tracks, once he finishes setting the levels, he'll join the rest of the band out in the studio. While the rhythm tracks are being recorded, the control room will be supervised by producer Peter Butcher.
You ready? Okay, well, let's go for it. Count in, Chuck, let's go for it.
Back out in the studio, which Peter can see from the control room through a wide double-paned glass window, each band member wears a headset while the recording is in progress. The headsets allow each of them to hear all of the music exactly as it's being recorded. Without the headsets, the drums are all they'd hear. As an added reference, while the initial rhythm section of the song is being recorded, lead singer Deborah Giles is also recording what's called a scratch vocal. Like each of the instruments, Deborah's voice is recorded on a separate track of tape. Later, her scratch vocal track will be deleted and replaced by a new and stronger vocal recording. Although the group spent a great deal of time arranging the song, rehearsing it over and over until they got the sound they wanted to record, getting it recorded that way can take several more hours. Once the tape is rolling, if everything doesn't sound just right, Peter interrupts.
Hold up, hold up. Chuck, could you lay into that snare a bit more?
Yeah.
You know, Ronnie's trying to drive it on through, and I think you're going to need to drive it with the snare, so...
Run a little more
time. Yeah, yeah. Ron, on your guitar thing, can you make your strokes definite? Da, 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 da. And you know, when you're dragging the pick up, don't drag it across the strings. Try not to come off on that sort of, that offbeat. Just all on the downbeat on that section. Let's do it again, Chuck.
All
right. It's all yours. Whoa, 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 come on, let's have it together from the beginning. Tape is rolling, you know.
The rhythm tracks and scratch vocal alone are not enough to complete the record. As Peter indicated earlier, they are merely a foundation for the song, on which he and the band will start to build.
I got a dream and you.
How'd that sound?
Yeah, it sounds pretty good. Sounds fine. Seemed to go down pretty well.
After the initial rhythm tracks have finally been laid down perfectly, a technique called overdubbing can be used to add the sounds of additional instruments. For when the world comes crashing through, 6 additional guitars will be added, each recorded one at a time on a new and separate track of the tape. Since the electric guitars are plugged directly into the audio board without having to use microphones, the overdubs can be played and recorded right in the control room. Between the two of them, Ron and Ronnie Johnson will play the additional guitar overdubs. For the first one, Ron will record a new lead guitar pattern at various points throughout the song. As he listens on the control room speakers to the playback of the original rhythm and scratch vocal tracks, he'll play along with the tape, recording the new guitar sounds at the same time on a new track.
Yeah.
When the first overdub is completed the way they want it, they'll repeat the process 5 more times, adding the sound of a new guitar each time. In all, the overdubs alone take several more hours to complete, but once they're finished, all of the music needed for the song will have been recorded onto the tape, but the song still isn't complete. To finish the recording, the master vocal track and vocal overdubs must be added. Again, lead singer Deborah Giles will sing the lyrics to the song. But this time she'll do it for keeps, erasing the scratch vocal track she recorded earlier, and she'll do it back out in the studio all alone. Since all of the music for the song has already been recorded, the band won't need to play for her. Instead, Deborah will listen to a playback of the recorded music in her headset and sing along.
I don't like the vocal part. The vocal part is real hard. I mean, it's hard to sing good, and I feel a lot of pressure on me by the time we get to that part because it's the last thing we do. So by then, I'm usually, oh no, I got to do this right. I got to get it.
Gonna do it again?
Yeah, it just sounds kind of.
Wishy-washy.
Kind of bad. I don't know, just flat or something. What do you think, Peter?
I guess you were out too late last night.
What?
What? Say to you.
You were out too late last night.
Besides the point. Okay. It don't know my name. A lot of times I'll stop myself just to ask, you know, Peter, how does it sound? Ron, how does it sound? And, you know, they get mad at me and say, it sounded fine. Why'd you quit?
I guess she's happy
so far. Does that sound right?
Are you not happy with that?
I don't know. You tell me.
Well,
Oh, it doesn't sound bad to me, does it, you?
Sounds like a keeper. Sounded good in here.
Sounds okay in here.
Okay,
yeah.
After the master vocal track has been laid down, Deborah has to record her vocal overdubs. In this case, the vocal overdubs are a more difficult special effect. It's a four-part harmony using only Deborah's voice. Deborah's part is simple enough. Sing four sustaining notes, which will be recorded one at a time on separate tracks.
Go.
When the song is mixed into its final form, those four individual notes will be played back together. The effect you'll hear when the record is finished will sound like a small choir, quietly fading in and out at the beginning, in the middle, and at the end of the song. But all of the voices you'll hear will belong to Deborah. The vocal overdubs mark the end of the recording process. In all, 22 of the 24 available tracks were used in this recording, but now those 22 tracks must be mixed together and recorded onto a two-track stereo tape. This final mix is the critical last step for Ron and Peter. It's here that they will have to decide exactly how they want the song to sound on the record.
Yeah.
At this point, any of the 22 tracks can be played back alone or together with any of the other tracks, all at the push of a button.
It don't know my name. I can live without it as long as my name.
Suppose guitars,
yeah.
What Ron and Peter have to do now is find the balance they want when all of the tracks are played back together, deciding which ones they want to use and at what point in the song. They'll set the volume and tone they want for each instrument and the vocals. They'll also decide which tracks will go on the right side of the stereo recording, which will go on the left, and which will go on both. Once they've set the levels they want on each track, they'll play the song several times, listening and adjusting each track until they get the feel for the mix they want.
Now, the thought that I have was that if we start with the vocals on their own and then just bring the rest of it underneath it.
Right.
Almost up to where Deborah starts singing. So they would go out there.
Yeah.
Or we'll put them out. I don't think we want to pop them out, we'll fade them out.
Okay.
When the mix of the song feels right to them, the last step is to get it recorded that way. Now, they'll play back the 24-track tape one more time and record the mixed version of the song in stereo on the quarter-inch recorder.
Oh, that'll work.
When they get it right and they're happy with the recorded mix, their work is done, and the tape is ready to be sent to a sound lab, in this case, one in California, to be mastered. The mastering process is simply a fine-tuning of the completed tape prior to having the records pressed. What happens to the record now will depend a great deal on how good it is, and maybe a little luck. For Peter Butcher in Private Lives, once the record is released, all that's left to do is wait to see how well the song they've created will do.
It's fun to take something and develop it, and it's like painting a picture. You know, you start with a white sheet and you do a pencil sketch, which to me is basically a rhythm pattern. You know, does it look right? Does it sit right on the paper? And then you start to add the color, and then the final mix is the way it looks, and it either sits right on the wall or it doesn't. If it does, you may have a hit record.
Right now, 47 degrees, and we have a new group we're proud to bring to you. The group is called Private Lies, the name of the song, When the World Comes Crashing Through. This was recorded here in Austin. Hopefully, they'll have an album coming up.
I can live without it as long.
Very good. A lot more involved than I thought there was ever involved in making a record.
Most people don't know all the work that's
no
put into it.
No kidding. It's tough work. Looks very difficult. How long were they actually in the studio doing all of that and trying to make the record?
They were in the studio for a period of over 10 days, 10 days to 2 weeks. They weren't in there for 8 hours a day, though. It was, the time varied. So
now, are these records always made this same way?
Well, the basics are the same. You can, you know, lay down the rhythm track, add your vocals. There are style differences that all the producers and the groups do differently. They might want to record the drums isolated in a booth by themselves,
or things
like that.
Or maybe the voice track first, or something like
right,
that.
Right. Yeah. There are basic standards that everybody follows. Then it's the creative process that takes over.
How's their song doing?
They're doing real well.
Are
it's
they?
Being When the World Comes Crashing Through is being played right now on K98. The Flip Side is
great.
Doing well. It's called Cautious Dreams is being played on Key 103. They're being played across the state on a few stations across the country. And it's been selected by Billboard. It's been featured in Billboard magazine.
Wow.
So it may be on its way.
It may be a hit record, and this would be their first.
That's right, and they're also in the process right now of recording an album.
Very good. Ed, thanks so much for showing us how a hit record is made, and we'll keep our fingers crossed for Private Lives. We'll take a break and be back in just a minute. Stay with us.